millions of people, and the pastor says, "What is prayer?" And I froze. And I thought, I'm not going to be confirmed. And then my friend next to me said, "It's a heart-to-heart conversation with God." And I said, "It's a heart-to-heart conversation with God." And I could be confirmed. After 2 years of confirmation, worship notes, sermon notes, going to Sunday school every year, being filled with fear and Lutheran guilt, I could be confirmed, and I could have communion, and I could be in a youth group. Louise, you and I think we are kindred sisters. I think we maybe grew up in the same church, just miles apart, right? And we can have communion for the first time from Monday to Thursday. With time, the church, Christ's church, has become a place where there is not an emphasis anymore on fear and intimidation, but thankfully a lot of grace and love and welcoming of all people to the Lord's table. There was a time when, in the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, in our church, where the age for communion training was thought to be fifth grade. And then it went to fourth grade, and then it went to third grade, and now in the church, it is whenever the parents feel that their child is ready, whenever there is an eagerness, a joy, a wanting to be at the Lord's table to receive the bread and wine. And so when that time happens, families from our church can come and bring their children and the parents, and we make this five-week journey together, studying about the Blessed Sacrament. And it's a grace-filled journey. We have the parable for us this morning from Matthew chapter 20. It's called the Parable of the Gracious Landowner. And it starts out like a lot of other parables in the Gospels with these words: "The kingdom of heaven is like." And then the story continues. And it goes on to tell a story about a landowner who needs workers in his vineyard. It's a story of God and people. The vineyard is God's kingdom. God is the vineyard owner. We are the laborers that work in the kingdom, and the payment at the end of the day is the same for you and me. The same for everyone. And that payment, that blessing, is the love of God, the salvation of Jesus, and the blessing of the Holy Spirit. This parable goes against a lot of what we're taught about success in our world, certainly in our society. It doesn't matter if you were called into God's kingdom at 6 in the morning, which was the start of workday in biblical times, if you were called into God's kingdom at 6 in the morning, or 9, or noon, or 3, or 5, the end of the biblical workday is 6. So you went 6 in the morning until 6 in the evening. It doesn't matter. That's what this parable says. What matters is that God called you to be a servant. No matter what time of the day it was in your life, that God called you and invited you and loves you as a servant and as a child. We all receive equal amounts of God's grace and mercy and love enough to sustain us in life. The greatest blessing is being in God's family, a precious and priceless gift that we're given at one place, in baptism. And when we're given that gift of grace and mercy and love of God through baptism, it is enough. It is enough to sustain us in life's journey, because we're joined together in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. In your life and in my life, we know an abundance of God's goodness. Martin Luther called these daily bread blessings. So in the small catechism, there is a question on the Lord's Prayer, an explanation of Luther about what does daily bread mean. And Luther says it means things like food and drink and shelter and family and friends neighbors, clothing, property, peace, health, decency, and honor. We have all of those things. It's a lot to be thankful for. You and I will always have more than some. We actually all have more than most people in the world have, because we live here in this blessed country. We have more than most people in the world, each of us. Even if you don't feel like you have very much, you have more than most people do. However, there will always be people you know that have more than you. A bigger home, a fancier car, more in their savings, more in their retirement. They can go on a cruise every year, whatever. A lot of daily bread blessings. When it comes to what you have, what God has given you, are you thankful? Can you be thankful and content with what God has given you? Or do you fall into that oh-so-human trap, which I think a lot of people do, that you wish you had more? You wish you had that bigger car, or that fancier car, or that bigger financial portfolio, or anything that someone else has. And then do you, beyond wishing for it, do you think they don't deserve it? All of this plays in to this parable. It connects with this parable. I think that the kingdom of heaven is a place where all people are welcome and where all people are treated by God with equality. A few years ago, I was talking with this young man's mom this week and asked her if it was okay to include her son, and she said absolutely in this story. So a few years ago, in our first community class, we had a whole bunch of kids. We usually have at least 6 or 8 kids every year. That year, I think we had 15. And so we had a really big class. And in that class of 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th grade kids, we had one young man who was 25 and who was autistic. And you know, when Alex came to the class, nobody judged him. Nobody said he was too old. Nobody said he wasn't smart enough or that he didn't belong in the class, but all of those children and their parents welcomed Alex and loved him as a brother in Christ. To me, it was a slice of heaven on earth to see that equality and that welcome and that inclusion. May God bless us with open, loving, kind hearts toward God, toward each other, as we live faithfully as servants. Amen.